Oh, what a scene, huh? Hey, I love it. Let me say good morning. I'll tell you what you were looking at there. Let me get rid of this timer. It didn't click off this morning for some reason. I'm not sure. You were looking at a scenic piece that I shot. Goodness, I guess it was Wednesday or Thursday morning, maybe. Maybe it was Thursday morning. I shot that just north of Asheville, North Carolina. There's a little town called Weaverville. If you're from there, it's called. Oh, wait a minute. I think my mic's on. It's called Wherville. Wherville, if you're from there, right? It's like living in Rutherfordton, but you don't say Rutherfordton, you say Rutherfordton. And so Weaverville or Wherville is about 13 miles north of Asheville, North Carolina. There's a camp there that Young Life has operated since 1970. So this year is its 50-year celebration. And so all this year, we're supposed to do a big gathering in May. I've been doing videos and stories about that because I was there in 1974. That last building that you saw pan over from that willow tree to that long building there was the dining halls. It opened up with a Flat Creek Inn. This is on Upper Flat Creek Road, and there were some old logs there from a pre-Civil War log cabin. And I was sitting there on one of those logs one day in maybe in June, could have been July. I better get the dates right on this. And sitting next to me was this young lady who had been friends with me at my last year of high school, and we had just worked together, and we're just the dearest of friends. And I had moved there and realized, whoops. She was more than a friend. And so I asked her to marry me on that porch. And then, unbelievably, they offered me an opportunity to live there. And so we moved there in the first part of December. We were married in November. Long engagements are like cowboys would say, they're like night shirts. They're not really necessary. And so we just got married, and because I'd known her for the last 3 years, out of high school into her college and University of Tennessee, and we were there. And so I just knew this person was a great friend, and that's Carol Ann, or Crayola, as they called her in college, because she did all her art projects with crayons. And wore sometimes a long dress that she'd made out of two pair of overalls that were just split apart, and it was a long dress. It was a crazy thing, and she had a bag made out of the other leg, and an artist from the word go carried crayons in the little upper pocket of her overalls, and her overall dress. That's even weird to say. And so anyway, there's a little story for you. I spent 3 days there this past week telling stories about. Just the legacy of that place and what it does for high school folks and the ministry. And there have been over 600,000 campers that have come through that facility. 600,000. So what an opportunity. I spent time with three friends that we go back over 45 years, 40 years for sure. And we picked up just like that. Interviewed a lot of people. Anyway, so it made me really excited about just being taking a walk down history, and pretty cool, pretty cool. All right, let me say hi to some of you here, and let me catch up with you just a bit. So thank you. It's Saturday morning somewhere in the world. I'm having a cup of builder's tea. It's bold, it's strong, it's black, it's here's what it looks like. I just keep the tea bag floating in there. Somebody on one of the shows last week from London said, "Blimey, he's still got the tea bag in his tea." I didn't hear you say it, but I could read it as you said it in your wonderful accent. And yeah, I keep it floating in there. And so, Builder's Tea, make mine a Builder's is what I call it. You know, they're not a sponsor yet. Actually, they are friends, though. They sent me. Just sent me a hat and a box and said, "Hey, thank you for telling people about our tea." And I'm going like, "That's not my job. I've just been drinking this stuff for many years." It took me about 40 blends of tea to go through until I found the one I like. So hello to you, top of the morning, Lori Stanley Henderson. I love the three names. Reminds me of Stanley Meyer and Handelman, who was a storyteller in the past. Tamberly, thank you. Shanlyn, Chris Whitaker, Tish Brown, Donna Barton, creative artist. Glenda Small, Bob from the inspiring, awe-inspiring cornfields of Iowa, man. And I appreciate your intro, so I had to show you some of my Weaverville places. Carol and I moved there in 74. We lived there almost 10 years. I was responsible for a lot of the development, the program, not development in the buildings, but a lot of the program stuff. and just got to do some fun stuff. We went back in the barn and didn't take any instruments with us, but a couple old hats and sang some old songs, and just for fun. Did some live streaming from there to a group. Lucy Springs, thank you for being here. Lucy Springs sounds like a place, and I love that so much. Robert Small, there he is, man, from the mountains of Veracruz. Randall Craven, Linda, thank you for being here. Andy McKean, glad you're here. Terry Tardy, welcome to you. Terry Tardy knows all about young life in Coos Bay, Oregon. Karen Bender, is it Binder, I think? Lynn Miner, Patricia Brooks, wow. Jean-Paul Schubert, man, I've been talking about you several times. Sometimes, Jean-Paul, I pull out the journal. I don't even know if it's still up here. I think it is, but I pull out the journal from France just a little over a year ago, Jean-Paul. JP, as we call him. We were in France together, and that man was a tour guide and a half. In fact, I told the story yesterday to someone about us helping the man get his boat out of a jam in the Bay of Ardon. You have to say it like you're a pirate. Ardon. And I was talking about how we got the boat out and he was in a jam, and then his mom comes running out later, chases us down that little trail and said, here. And she gave us a jar of apple jelly. And I love it, man. So bless you, my friend. No, you've had a whirlwind with your family. And to Pepe, who has gone on to a better place. Yes. All right. Jonelle, Donna Bellick, Tamberly Marie, Christine Fowler. Good night. Look at you people pile on this show this morning. Jackie, Virginia, Nicole, Viv, love your art. Lynn, thank you for being on Saturday morning. I miss Lynn. Lynn and Meg, you're on Saturday morning. Awesome. Skeeter Pal, I've been there. You have been there, Skeeter Pal. As a matter of fact, let me connect you all. Skeeter Pal and I are... we're running in that age group with some of you friends, and when I went there as a just literally right in between my college years, I was going to be a work crew guy there, just serve there for a month in the summer. So they have this work crew boss, and Skeeter Powell, who's on this show, learning to paint skeeters and bees, was my work crew boss, man. So we've connected for 48 years. That's unbelievable, isn't it? Man. I love it. Talking about history, talking about finding something to paint about. Denise, thank you for being here. Pat, Cindy, Fern, Margie, Carol Hahn, Carol Hugh, Patricia. Meg says she loves Weaverville. Weaverville was two hardware stores and a church that turned into a library because they built a church up the street a little bit. And then now it is like, you know, you can get sushi in Weaverville. I'm going like, it's a long way from the sea. What are you people thinking here? Brenda, welcome to the show. Raylene from California. Ruth Ann. There's just so many people who piled on the show this morning. Michael Ash Ashburn. Mike was there with me. Ash and I were in the mountains together. I have a video of him standing in a wagon being silly. I know that's going to be hard for some of you people to picture. Not necessarily, right? Shanoa, thank you for being on here. Danielle, Mickey, Heather. I'd love to just... okay, here we go. Already had a cup of Joe. There's stories to tell. All right, folks, here we go. Hey, thought I'd do a little warm-up painting this morning. Thanks for humoring me. Not that you had any choice, right? I had that video, and I ran it on live stream for several thousand people who follow this camp and its development and its concern for it and getting high school kids who didn't get to go there this summer. There's this pristine property. And it's brilliant in so many ways. And then there's this one problem. High school folks can't go there. And you realize the pressure that we feel with COVID, right? Think of how they feel in their own world. I mean, seriously, they're high school kids, they'll get over it. No, they're pretty bound up. So it's pretty awesome. Anyway, hey, here's my warm-up book this morning. Let's paint something. I don't know if I can find the spot where I was. I don't even know what. Oh, there's, I marked it, I think. Here we go. Look at this. I've just about run out of pages to paint on in my warm-up book. So there it is. I found a page this morning that I had colored it in sort of a dingy brown leaf coffee stain. In fact, I may have done that with coffee. And so the word that I had highlighted here, and you see it right there, is called Knick Knick. And some of you might remember this from the old Western movies years ago, where the North American Indians and the settlers all sort of came together, and if they offered each other peace, which wasn't very often because we were pounding on them, and no wonder, and we wanted the land, and they were pounding on us, no wonder, they've been on the land forever, and yet... sometimes they would sit down and they would smoke a peace pipe together, and inside that peace pipe was kinnick kinnick, and that was dried sumac leaves and willow and dogwood bark and buffalo chips. Yeah, buffalo chips. Mmm, hospitality. And so, the word comes from Unami. It's an Algonquian language, so it's an Indian word, but its meaning was simply mixture. So you can say, this book, if I ate it this morning, tastes a lot like kinnick kinnick. And you could probably wrinkle up the pages and smoke it. And that's why everybody said, good, good, real good. All right. Hey, so here we go. Let's do a little warm-up here. Because I'm drinking tea and I'm spraying some water on my paint here this morning just to loosen it up a little bit. Some of you have been sending me some pictures of your art, and every now and then I go on Roos Crew. Roos Crew, of course, is a page that some of you started. I love it so much. I go in there and see how you're sharing with one another and what the heck you're talking about, and how you're taking and finding ideas and painting, and I absolutely love it. It's pretty remarkable that you've created this community of people, of artists around the world. Around the world. Do you know last Tuesday's show, there was Dubai there. 48 years ago, Neil Mowry says, and Neil, buddy, you're on my prayer list. I'm going to put you on the wall here. 48 years ago, you and I were sitting on the back row in the chorus class. Yes, we were. Coach, we called him. We called Mr. Scarborough. How'd I do? I pulled that out, didn't I? Mr. Scarborough, and you'll go, oh my gosh, that was his name. We called him Coach. His eyes sometimes moved if he stopped and looked at you. And I've told some stories about him already, how we sang a song one time in a contest, and it was a sight reading thing, and we'd been practicing this song just for fun. And lo and behold, the place at the University of Tennessee where we sang told us that we couldn't change the music. We had to do this cold read, and we did Bach single swingers. Isn't it crazy how that stuff still rattles around up there? Neil, I did not remember that, but it seems like I almost do, and it's weird how you sort of put thoughts together in your mind like that, but that's fabulous, man. Where is your picture in picture today? Miss your face. Thank you, Terry Tardy. It's because I've just got carried away. There I am. Ah! So I'm telling stories and forgot that you're even looking at me. I've been doing this one-sided for 3 days. Man, I've been out of pocket. This is the first 3 days. This week had 3 days that I didn't pick up a paintbrush in a long, long time. I mean, probably, it's been months and months and months, way before COVID started. Probably in February, I shot some video pieces and I didn't paint. It's been crazy. All right, so listen to this. I'm painting this as a reminder today. See it right there? I don't use white paint very often, but I'm just piling it on here really thick so it might stay on this piece of paper. But I'll tell you, there's a piece of good news with my painting this morning. Kinnick, kinnick. I don't know what you're going to put in your cup, but after COVID, after a slowdown in the mail, after a printing snag, your pre-order Roodoodles diner mugs have arrived, and so they're being addressed and posted, and or postage is put on them. They're being packaged today, and they'll be. In fact, I hope to send you a picture Monday morning of them all being sent out. And so I know you're excited. Thank you for your patience. I'm maybe just as excited. I hate to do that because we thought everything's ready to go. Let them roll. I had paid the money, signed everything out, and then started selling them to you guys and said, okay, is this going to happen? This is going to turn around in a heartbeat. And then I started getting these little notifications and it said, okay, that's not going as fast as you thought it was going. And welcome to several other things. I had some stuff that I was supposed to take with me on this trip that it doesn't show up. And you just go, welcome to the world we live in right now. So we're slowing down just a little bit. All right. Yay, mugs are on their way. Can't wait. It's the first time I've seen you watercolors, your white watercolor show that well. Well, the reason it's showing that well is because I'm painting on a dark background. And so I painted that in there, and now I'm going to take a little bit of this this gray and this gray here and just kind of come up with a little bit of steam rising up out of there. And then maybe just get a little bit of splatter steam here like this. And then I might put a little brown around the corners here, a little chocolate down here just in case I got a spill. And then maybe just tape a brush of this, a wet brush, and just let it sort of run down the cup like that. Even tip the book up, look at this, and just let it run down. It's okay if all this runs right here too. There we go. So very abstract, but that gives you what we were searching for. If I wanted to come in and highlight a little of the handle, I could do that with... And Heather, if you want to purchase a mug, there's still some available. And by the way, they've all come shipped now. You can go to roodoodles.com, and there's some mugs out there. The mug looks like this, by the way. Here it is right here. Zoop. That's it right there. I got to tell you, this may be one of those projects that I lose my shirt on because it weighs over a pound. And that's before it's in the box. Okay, I told you the reason I wanted a, and by the way, the company that made these mugs is my favorite company of all time. So I splurged on that. It's called M. So they're a big, thick, heavy diner mug. It takes two hands to hold one like this. You can, it holds the drink. It holds your cup of whatever, tea, coffee, hot chocolate this winter. It holds it warm for a long time. It'll warm your hands. You can pour hot bacon grease in it, stick it right into the fridge, and then let it congeal and spoon it out to make gravy. Mm-hmm, I've been there. You can milk one goat in it. It'll hold one goat. And you can also, if somebody snatches your purse, you can take them out at about 25 feet. It's a pound and 3 ounces. That's a big old mug. So it's coming shipped to you, and it has... just like most mugs, you think, oh, I thought the logo was going to be here. No, the logo's looking at you. So when you look at it like this, you're just going, oh, that's pretty awesome. So you can always turn it around to your friends. I guess so for your left-handed friends, it will be to the outside. So there's the blessing in being left-handed. But as most mugs, like my hat, Show Prince mug, which I love here, it's on the inside. Go to roodoodles.com if you want one, and we'll start piling out labels and sending them through. Okay, so that'll be it. Let me get this picture out of the way here and go back to what I was doing before I rudely interrupted myself, which is what I do. Okay, there's our warm-up painting for this morning. And you don't see me paint slow very often. In the background, while we were at the camp, this listen to this. Oh, Chip Fur says you can reheat that mug on a griddle. Spoken as an expert who is a heck of a chef, but a heck of a coffee roaster. And Chip, that's our next project. Now that the mugs are here, we're going to be turning loose some of that brew coffee. So I'll be over to see you soon, buddy. So I hear a little banjo in the background, and I'm going to turn that down so nobody can hear it but me, kind of. And I'm going to draw a little picture this morning because I came in here not knowing what I was going to do today. That's what happens on Saturday mornings. And so I thought I'd do a little a rooster and a banjo. Every now and then I just paint a rooster and a banjo. So here it goes. Sometimes to do this, I put the banjo in first. Let me move my head up out of the way here just a little bit. Get out of the way just a little bit right there. Shrink me down just a little. Big head. Hey, drink. There we go. Margaret Meisinger says she drinks coffee with her left hand anyway, so she can paint with her right. That's cowboy right there. All right. And Randall Taylor Craven says you received the book. Thank you. Love the subtle curve on the mug. Yes, of course. Look at the subtle curve on the mug. That's what makes those diner mugs to me. And who wants to drink out of a sharp-edged little cup where you have to keep your thing out? Okay, there's a time for a tea cup with a queen, but this is... a mug. All right. And Chip, thanks for being on this morning. We'll talk about that. What was the word, Rue? The word was kinnick-kinnick, Rab, from Australia. I don't know if you guys have kinnick-kinnick over there, but it's, Rab, here's what it is in Australia. I don't think you're in New Zealand. No, Rab, you're in Australia. Kinnick-kinnick is when you just take a blend of willow branches and sumac and bark and buffalo chip and maybe some old rust off the barn, and you put all that in ground it up and see if you can get it lit and smoke it in a peace pipe. I guess you can make tea out of it, but I'm not telling you can, okay? I didn't say this was a safe show, all right? So here's a roux. Sometimes when I start a roux like this, I draw the banjo head first just so I know I got it in there the way I like it. Banjo heads have two rings. You know how I know that? Because I play one very poorly, and they have a bridge right here. Then they have a tailpiece. It's kind of an oversized triangle like that. And my banjo had it was five string. So it's got one tuner down there, and then it comes up here like this. It breaks off with a bridge piece right here. And then it has now Neil Mallory's banjo is a five string. He plays what's called Neil, who's on the show this morning from Knoxville, or from Maryville, Tennessee. I don't want to say you're from Knoxville, Neil. His banjo, and Neil, I haven't painted a banjo in a while, brother, and so it's good that you're on the show today. I should have had the banjo piece that you made for us out. I don't think I can get to it right now with the show closed down and running. It's in a hard drive sitting over here. But Neil plays a clawhammer style, and there was Scrugg style where you played with three fingers like this with picks. Then there's clawhammer, which you play a bump ditty. So you hit your finger, you hit your thumb on the fifth string, go bump, and then there's this bump, ditty, bump, and you pull off, and the rhythm is picked out with your index finger. And we used to say in the mountains, it's the only kind of banjo you can play if you've had a chainsaw accident. That's kind of gross, but that's what we would say to all our friends who were clawhammer banjo pickers. All right, so you can see these two roos are, he may be standing on the ground here, and she's sitting up on the bench. There's a hen and a roo, and they're doing a little tune together, a little tune I like to call, I'll come up with it, a little tune I like to call something. I love how bluegrass songs are named sometimes. They're named like for places and... there's a song that Hartford does, and I'm listening to him this morning, the old John Hartford. Let's see if I can just find it here. This is John Hartford. I'm listening. I just get shut down all the time by... here we go. That's not it. I'll give you a little banjo though while I play this. I do paint faster when I hear that, don't you? Steel guitar, the hardest instrument to ever play. Flat pick guitar right there. Made me think we used to do a barn thing at the camp that I showed you this morning where we would bring out all the instruments and kind of come down to the barn and play some stuff. It's pretty awesome. So I guess that's why this was fresh on my mind today. Pretty funny how that works, isn't it? There's what we call doghouse bass right there. I miss sitting on the porch and doing music like this with guys. There's where he picked up his bow and starts to bow the bass. Is that cool? Cindy, I've got you guys your book. All right, there's your little tune right there, little small little thing. See if I got an eraser somewhere. I'd like to have one up here. Then I'll turn the music down. Oh, there's a little piece of one. So I sketched this with a pencil. That's when you don't know the words, you just go, Ethan, they called it. All right. Well, I just about got that sketch during that time. So my paintings, those of you who have been painting with me in September on Rue 857, and the class closed last night for Rue 857 October, closed at 8:57 p.m. Eastern. So that class is going to be done, and you'll be getting an email from me probably sometime, another one today. You may have gotten one last night, but you'll get a final today, but you will get an email of those of you who are registered. I sent out an email to everyone yesterday about final signups. You'll get an email that says, here's where you go. Here's where you wait. And it's going to be about a day and a half until I open the page. So the page is not open. And I'm putting some videos on there, a couple start assignments that I want you to do. Did I use the word assignment? Sorry, I'm taking this to heart here. You need to get your things together, all the things that you need. There's a page there. Glenda, thank you. Always got to put his foot on a bucket because that's what you did. You just pulled up a stump or a bucket and you had that. And Nicole, you just said, I hope I can ever draw that quick and loose. You know what? Change your music. If you've been painting to lullabies, it's hard to paint quick with a lullaby. Change your music. Go to some classical music. Put on the Flight of the Bumblebee when you draw bees. I know that sounds ridiculous, but sometimes that little touch makes your body want to just move a little looser. Isn't that weird? And I'm not a dancer. My wife can dance. I danced one time with her. That was the night we were married. And we came out and we did our dance. And I said, after that, I'll go to weddings with you, hon. I'll stand in the floor with you. I'll even hold your hand and spin you around, but then I got to go sit down and paint. So I take my bug out bag, which by the way are here too. The bug out bags have made it. The printer had them all lumped together, finally finished, so they're here. So you're going to love those when they come. And I'll take my bug out bag, a little thing of paint. I'll pop that open and some small paper, and I'll sit and paint and sip on some tea and... she'll dance until I have to go out and take her water, collect the shoes, and she'll dance the rest of the evening barefoot. Woman is crazy. All right, there's a little painting for you right there. Let's paint that thing. What do you say, okay? Linda, I hope your husband's not watching this, as my husband plays the banjo poorly too. The Osmond Brothers, which wrote Fox on the Run, they did it. They also did, what's the big song from Knoxville, Tennessee? Rocky Top, You'll Always Be. I saw the Osmond in concert back in 1970, summer of 74. Yep. He played your husband's cheap banjo on stage. I love it. Oh, you guys are great. Is that a button box? I'm not sure what you're asking me. Oh, that is a button box, Bob. Yes. There's a button box. I was going to call it an accordion. An accordion is one of those things you never need when you go deer hunting. So you can take an accordion with you in a few places. And most of the time, you get in serious trouble taking an accordion in places. I do like them on the street. I do like them in the street. I'm sorry. That's terrible. Isn't it? All right. Hey, let me throw a curveball at you today. Watch this. I'm going to grab an aqua brush. That's too big a one there. See if I got one that works up here. Try to see if this one works. Sometimes aqua brushes just don't work real well. They work for about 5 years, and you'd think I'd get my money out of them and just throw them away, but I don't know if this is going to work. So I'll use this one to wet it. This is a big one here. It might work. Oh, yeah, there we go. Got a little water coming out of that. Aqua brush is simply this. This is made by Pentel. You got to clean them out from time to time. This unscrews, and you can pour water down in the handle, put the top back on, and when you give it a little bit of a squeeze, it rolls through the filter and into the brush. And this is just a nylon brush here, and that allows you to paint when you're traveling. I painted a lot of my journal with an aqua brush on the train as I was coming back from places where we'd been. Not sure why this pen's not writing today. Wake up, got a piece of fiber in the, got a piece of fiber in it, looks like, yeah. Just taking a little bit of, Speedball ink. I don't know what that song was, but I liked it. I'll have to go back and look that one up. So see, I haven't even picked up any paint. You notice that? I'm just painting with the ink from my pen, which is what I love doing sometimes. Some of you have been discovering this from our last session in Rue 857. You've also seen me do it here quite a bit. It is so kind of fun. And like right in here, I would say these veins of this button box or this accordion, as Bob called it, a button box, I'd say those are need to be dark. That's the webbing that is the air push, the flow. All right, I'm cleaning this brush out, and I'm going back in. I'm going to go into a little bit of my red here. I just stuck my finger in the paint. Stuff happens when you do live. When you paint live, it's just messy sometimes. All right, grab a little bit of this red, come in here, and just, this is a big old brush to be painting this, but I think I can do it with it. So just stick with me here. Let's see what happens. While I got this red on here, I'll just go do the hen's little small comb and her big wattle underneath. There we go. Got the hen and the roo sitting there. This, by the way, is Kilimanjaro 140-pound paper. Let me show you what it is. It's my favorite paper. There it is right there. Kilimanjaro. It's made by Joe Miller, Cheap Joe's Art Stuff. It says, this will fool you. It says 300 GSM. Make sure you get, not GSM, that's metric. You want the 140-pound. Unless you want 300 pound, and then you're going to be talking about some serious, serious watercolor paper. 100% cotton. This is bright white, and I love that because the white pops through when I leave holidays, and those are the spaces that I don't go back and color in. I just leave, and I did say color, and so for those of you who think about how kids color everything in their artwork, don't do that. Leave a little bit of white space here and there to let some of the white of the paper just grace your painting, okay? All right, so I'm going to go over here in my color, and I'm just going to mix up a little bit of what I call leg color. Most of my colors are mixed on the paint itself. You guys have seen me do this so many times now. You know, I've still got to go back and figure out how many days I've actually been painting. Not in my life, just since I started the COVID thing, and I'll go back and count those up. It's been a few. So I come back in, almost knocked that off. Of course, I paint all my hens with a little bit of, and I get my brush cleaned out here. Paint all my hens with a little bit of French hen blue. Love that French blue. I think I'm going to make her just a little more full right here. Just going to drop some feathers down here too. Yeah, that gives her just a little bit more oomph. You got to be pretty stout to play an accordion. Those things are not light, you know. Accordion players sit on a 5-gallon bucket in the street of Paris and certainly Italy and play some tunes. You love that. That's kind of fun. Got to have a little Terry Tardy turquoise in there. There it comes right there. It's Andrew's turquoise. If you have to buy it at Cheap Joe's, if you want to buy it at Cheap Joe's, art stuff, it's called Andrew's turquoise, but I call it Terry Tardy turquoise because Terry Tardy is a friend, and she's been a displaced potter Okay, so when COVID hit, Potter's quit having shows. And in fact, I was in Magnum Pottery, who is one of our favorite potters, and his shop is open in the little town of Weaverville. And he said, it's been tough on us because we can't ship our work. It's just too expensive, too time consuming, just almost impossible to ship what we make. And so we're just relying on people to feel safe enough to walk in our store. So it's tough on artists right now. So I like to get out and meet some of them and talk to them about how they're doing and what's going on. And not to say that I'm blessed. I'll tell you I'm blessed. I'm blessed that all of you guys just sort of jump in here on the show in the morning and watch. And thank you for all your comments. Michael, you're going to do a Halloween rooster? Shanlin, I'm not. Thank you for asking, though. Halloween is just one of those things that I keep the light off and stay inside. And so you're welcome to ask. I did carve a pumpkin 2 years ago for a tool company. And I carved it with a power tool and for a commercial that I did for them. But that's about as far as I go on a Halloween rooster. So I won't be doing a Halloween rooster. I'll skip Halloween and go right into some Thanksgiving paintings. And then during November, I'm going to do a class. It's probably going to be in 2 weeks, but four classes in 2 weeks, probably maybe a Monday, Friday, something like that. And I'm going to do a lot of Christmas paintings. And my Christmas paintings have a purpose. They have a story, but also just some fun Christmas memories that I'll do with my Roodoodles. So thank you for asking, though. Just don't do Halloween, and but I do have a weakness, a major weakness. It's candy corn, and I think that's because roosters like corn, and I think that's why that's what my weakness is. So, all right. So you see this little painting coming together here. This is kind of fun, and when you get into details, you have to be sort of careful, more careful than I do. But I got this little painting going, and so I want some detail in the painting. So what I'll do sometimes is I'll come back in with my pen and I'll actually put some wood detail in here. Like I might put a bolt head or a nail head in the bench and some things here. Might put some marks on the bench. Might put a little dirt on the legs like this. I'll come back in and put some veining in the chicken legs. So sometimes when you're just painting what I call my whimsical sketches, and you're going to do some of these, or you're going to paint whatever it is you paint, flowers in a journal or wherever you go, don't worry about having everything so pristine and in between the lines. Just loosen up and have fun. Tell a story with your painting. And that's what I talk so much about in the classes that I'm trying to do here. This banjo needs some strings on it. And so what I think I'm going to do is find a pen that I like and I don't see it. Did it fall off the table? Maybe. Here's one right here. No, a 5 Pentel, which looks different than most of the 5s. These are plastic ones. They're ones I really kind of like, but they're hard to get a hold of. So I'm just going to throw some banjo strings on here. 3, 4, 5. Let them roll up, and then just put some strings out here. That little tail piece right there, I need a fine little brush. Get off there. I need a fine little brush here to give that just a touch of brass color right there. That's usually a brass piece on the banjo. And then let's put some dirt on the front of the banjo, because that's the way mine looks. Now this accordion needs some color to it, but accordions they're not only sound loud, they are painted loud. You know what I mean? They have a style of their own. The people who make accordions, they don't mess around. They want people to go, look at that accordion. So there may be a mixture of colors. There may be something that draws your eye. There's also going to be some ivory and some black keys right in there like that. There's going to be a little blue coming around on that hand right there. She's getting ready to hit a couple buttons, as Bob called it, the button box. I love that. Bob, if it turns out that you're an accordion player out in the cornfields of Iowa, you got to send us a video. singing through the cornfields, man, that's going to be awesome. Candy corn is my RX. Got a prescription for it. You got it, Miss Liz, Miss Carla. You got it. That's pretty fantastic. Candy corn and dry roasted peanuts in a bowl sounds like your husband was a dentist and he gave that to his clients. snap the tooth off, and then get the sugar down in there. Mercy, that sounds good. All right, so there we go. There's a little banjo playing Roo, and now what it needs is, I'm going to come in here with this pen right here, and I'm just going to dirty up the ground a little bit. So, and I just found an old line. Lee Packus, I think you're on the show today. I just thought of an old story from a song from our hoedown days that I can put on here. Maybe it's an old joke that we used to do in the barn. We used to do a hoedown, and it was called the Hillbilly Hoedown. Back then, it was toward ourselves. It wasn't an outward thing. We called it the Hillbilly Hoedown Redneck Review, and we would come in with overalls and old hats and instruments, and we would tell jokes and do stories and get kids who had come from the city to sing songs they had never heard before. And I got to tell you, it was one of my favorite. Throw some hay. Now it's wood chips on the floor, and just have a great time. And one of my favorite lines just came to me. I was thinking about what it is when musicians sit down. There's always that moment they have. It's what artists have. When you sit down to paint and you get everything ready, you've got your paint laid out, you've got your paper laid out, and you go, what am I going to paint? And sometimes you're just stymied and you sit there for a while, and then the fun sort of wears off and you finish your coffee and you go, oh yeah, I got to go call somebody. So what I do is I sort of go into it with a little bit of, what did I do yesterday that might bring itself into a painting? What did I see? What did I remember? And you know what it was? I came into my office yesterday after being on the road, and I came into this office here, and I put some of my paint supplies down at the... I'd taken them with me. I just didn't have time to paint. And I remember sitting in that hoedown barn, and in those, and I remember walking in there sometimes with a guitar, sometimes with a banjo, and getting those kids to sing and interacting with them. Stage time that we were just trying to be silly, to let their world know it's okay to just smile and let your hair down sometimes and be goofy. And so it's part of our process in doing that. And so it made me think of the banjo. And I came in here and I put some things down on that desk over there. And there hangs my banjo on the wall. And I thought of a banjo. When I sit back down here this morning, I thought Hartford, because he's one of my old-time favorite banjo players. He was a chromatic player, more talented than anybody I've ever seen on the banjo. And so that made me think of painting a banjo, which I do from time to time and haven't done in a while. And so... I think Neil may actually even have one. I think he's got a banjo player. A little bit of splatter up there, a little bit of dirt on the ground coming down here with a little bit of Payne's gray and a little touch of ugly brown in there. Ugly brown is one of my favorite colors, and not to paint with, but to accent with. So there it is. There's a little painting right there, and I've got a caption for it. I'm gonna let it dry, and then I'll come put the caption on. Let me jump on something else just for a minute. So there's my painting right there. Little Roo, he's sitting there. Doesn't look like he's playing yet. Wait, I see one little piece I could probably touch up. Just going to put a little something on this banjo right here, a little dark right in here on the top. And then I'm gonna come back in a minute and maybe put a little mark on the top of that neck. The banjo that I owned, I actually sold my banjo in Tokyo. It was handmade. It had curly bird eye maple neck with a pecan strip down the middle. It was called the Showboat. It was an open back pot, five string. And it just collected dust way over the years. We had a son that was getting married, and Carol and I needed the money more than I needed the banjo. And I put it out for sale, and it was a high dollar banjo. I'd gone and picked out the wood, picked out the tone ring, and a man had made it for me. Bud Sosby was a banjo maker. He'd made pieces like the Vega banjos and the old Daring banjos, and he said, I want to build you a showboat for your storytelling. So I went and sat with him, and we picked out the wood, and I'd go back about once a week for 3 or 4 weeks, and he'd show me where he was on it, cutting out the piece and sanding it down. It was gorgeous, but I just didn't use it and play it, and this guy contacts me through a translator in Tokyo and buys the banjo. And 2 years ago, I contacted him, and he still plays that banjo, and he has a collection. He has 40-something banjos. So, and he was a middle school teacher in to Japan, and he would bring in, hey, he loved American folk music. Okay, how weird is that, huh? I thought, man, if anybody knew. All right, so Jason, thanks for being on the show. Pat says at those hoedowns, you were the only real musician. Well, I was the only one that pretended I was anyway. So, I can hear the music just looking onto that drawing. Isn't that fun? Yeah, we'll have to figure out if I can ever get a little banjo piece going together here, and we'll see what happens. But I love... Listen to this.
Nobody knows what you do when you're all alone. It's just you. When you're on your own, it's just you. Nobody knows what you do. Nobody knows what you say. Whether you're working, whether you're playing, you can sure have your
way. It's Saturday morning. I'm having a concert.
And for sure, no one will ever know. You can come and you can go.
Nobody knows what you do. Hey, don't you love that? Thanks for joining in my party today. Let me get another painting going here for you because I said I would. I think I had another piece of art here somewhere. I'm just going to take this page and rip it off right here. This will trim. It'll trim at about 5.5 by 8 when it's all done. And that'll make a great little size small works painting. Remember, that's painted on Kilimanjaro Bright White. This is a paint book. And a lot of folks say, oh, I don't like those rings. They're too clubby. One of the things I do like for them in paint is that it folds over flat. And I love this one because, hey, boys, hold it down. I do like this one because it has these pages in here, and I can work out little ideas sometimes on my pages. These are for something else I'm working on. I can't tell you what that is right now. But it'll have this page like this. And there's a nice little workable page, and this is pretty good sketch paper, so I can come in and think, okay, I want to sketch something here. There's that little coffee cup with that rim in it. It's got that little bow in it, and here's the handle coming over. So if I wanted to do something like that, I could use this as a sketch page. I had another painting laid out here that I was going to do for you this morning. I don't know what I did with it. I'll find it. Just give me a minute. Or I'll open up a painting and do another one. Did I do with that piece of painting? Here we go. Let's see if I can do this really quick here. Yeah, I got 10 minutes. I can make a little painting. I was going down memory lane yesterday. When we drive, sometimes my mind just goes. Carol was reading a piece, and we were in my old truck because I had so much equipment to take. And I think she just shuts her eyes and rides in the truck because she's thinking, why are we driving this old truck when I have a nice convertible? I'm going like, I'll tell you why. It's because all my camera gear won't fit in your convertible. And so anyway, but I thought of this painting here, so I thought this would be a funny one to do. We took our family a few years ago to one of our favorite places many, many years ago. They were still young. No one married then, so it was our three kids. And we took off to... Jekyll Island, Georgia, and there's a Jekyll Island Resort is there, and the resort is it's a pretty awesome place. I used to go there and storytell a long time, so they would invite me up as the guest storyteller, and I got to tell you, it was fantastic, and I'd come in and do all kinds of stories and all kinds of crazy stuff, and so I got the opportunity to, what happened to my music? It just quit. Oh yeah, there we go. That went down too far, didn't it? I know why. Hartford's being crazy. We used to go to the Jekyll Island, Georgia, and they had a international, ready for this? International croquet court. And my kids loved it. And so we would take whites. We would take all our whites. And we would dress completely in white. And we would rent the court out. And we would get on that court. And we would play tough, tough, tough croquet. And man, it was the most fun thing that you could do with the family. I'm telling you, we just loved it so much. So for some reason, yesterday driving up the road, I was thinking about a friend of mine that lives near there, and I thought, man, I would love to go back to Jekyll and paint from their big porch. It's an all wooden hotel on Jekyll Island. It looks like a castle. And we used to have lunch outside there, and awesome place. I think I need to go back and play some croquet there. There's a good example of oversketching. See what I did here? I sketched this little roux in here this morning when I sat down when my tea was hot, and I put him right here. Well, he really wasn't in perspective. So sometimes this is why you sketch light like an ice skater skates on thin ice, because I'll just take that sketch out of there if I can go back and find my little piece of eraser. I've got 15 good erasers here, but I can't find any of them. So I saw where I planned that, but now I'm just actually moving him out of the way, the one I sketched, because now I've got my placement. So that's why sometimes you will actually sketch a little bit before you paint. And that works really well for the way I work anyway. So this is a 5 pintail right here. It's a pintail. It's inner gel. It's needle point. Let's see. Awesome banjo story. Love the banjo music. Thank you. Do you know where Bryson City is? I do. I know Bryson City very well. My mom used to play the guitar. Look at that. And a square dance caller. And all join hands and you circle the ring. Stop where you are. Give your partner a swing. Swing that girl behind you. Swing your own if you found she hasn't flown. Howl a man left with a sweet corner maid. Do-si-do your own. Now promenade with a sweet corner maid. Singing, oh, Johnny, oh. Yeah, who hadn't called a square dancer, too? If you haven't, you missed out on some of the fun things of life. I could call many square dances. I just couldn't dance my way out of a wet paper sack, as the saying goes. Okay? So this just came to me this morning, just a little while, about a minute and a half before I went on air with you guys. I call it on air because it is live to me. I mean, I have to be careful. Can you see how careful I'm being? Look, here's what I want to say to you as I start to encourage you. We wind the show down today. Many, many people who watch this show and who send me emails, and I'll send some notes back to you when I look at all your posts here, because I can't just respond to everybody that's on here and paint too. I'll try and answer as many as I can. Some of you just make comments and I'll hit a like, or I'll just say, wow, thank you for the comment. I won't say anything to you. But at the same time, what I'd like for you to do is don't stop posting on here. Don't stop sharing my page. And if you like it and you like something, hit the little like button and let me know, or hit the little love it button or something. It helps on Facebook, because those guys sort of give me a standing to say, hey, that whatever what that guy's doing, some people around the country appreciate him. And so they're all keeping up. And it helps our community when I start new pages. And so they sort of are found in the algorithm of Facebook, which is as weird as it gets. Okay, so there, Facebook, I just said that y'all are as weird as it gets. And who can figure it out? I don't know. And here's what I don't want to do. I'm never going to use it for political reasons. I'm never going to use it for proselytizing anything here. I'm just who I am, and I'm painting to have fun, and you guys should come along on this ride. But those of you who send me notes, who say, I've been painting acrylic for 5 years or 10 years, or I started with oil in high school, and now I'm in college, and now I've retired from college, and now I've retired from life, and I need a hobby. Though some of you are saying, but I'm just so afraid of watercolor. Well, don't be. It's just water. You make tea with it. I'm the guy who paints in a linen shirt in this. Maybe got spots on it already. A wrinkled linen shirt, because I just like the feel of linen. I got used to wearing it when I lived in Florida for 12 years, and I still keep it today in the Carolinas. It's just pigment. It's just colors. And sometimes the paint is just paint. You know, you just go in there, and you take a little bit of a pen and ink, and you touch it up, and you just let it do what it's supposed to do. Don't push it. Don't force it. Be surprised and sometimes astonished by the surprises and the elements of what happens when you just let the colors and the pigment do what they're supposed to do, okay? Hey, I've got, 8 minutes here. I can do this. Watch this. Clear some stuff out of the way. Let's move this stuff over here. And I wonder how the paint, the color gets knocked off my brushes, right? I think you can see that well enough right there. Okay, so here we go. Let's start over here on this side. So I'm right-handed. I'll start over here. There's a roux. I might as well do this one. I can reach in and do it this morning. There's a little one here. There's a little peep. Okay, got him colored in. Put this blotter paper right here. Use a paper towel. But what I was going to say is don't be afraid of watercolor. Just jump in and do it. Look, paper may cost a lot if you buy some nice watercolor paper, which the better you get, the better you start to paint. Good watercolor paper will make a huge difference in how you paint. So at some point in time along the line, choose the best paper that you love and that you can afford, and choose a brush that really feels like an extension of what you're trying to do on paper. I've added some brushes. I love a bamboo brush because it holds a lot of water. My daughter paints with a squirrel tip brush. It's like a mop on a short handle, but she knows how to control it with her wildflowers and her painting classes. And she has a painting class that starts again, I think, October 14th when mine starts. And she paints wildflowers. I think she just did wildflowers. She's maybe doing birds this time. Consider the birds. So she's going to be painting birds. And her painting classes are, to me, they're very devotional driven. I mean, she is a great speaker and just has a marvelous time painting. And so I, on the other hand, am an old Looney Tune who tells stories about life and gets you to. All right, see what I did there? That's a trick sometimes I'll do. I put a little bit of this yellow color in the wings like that to just give them a little bit of a tint. And I let it sit for just a minute to soak into the fibers. But before it gets dry, I just touch it with a light paper towel like this. And then if you were to look at this from my view, you still see a little bit of that color in the wings. Isn't that cool? And I'm going to come in with a little bit of orange and just do the kind of the same. This is just a pile of bees, and so I don't have to be detailed. I don't have to be whatever. You see that their honeybees are coming in. A little bit of this bright gamboge or gamboge, the yellow here, depending on what part of France you're from, Jean-Paul. Gamboge or gamboge. I don't know what it means. I think it was a color. Somebody told me on this show that they looked it up. How clever. You looked it up and you said, I think it's from a plant that actually monks' robes were dyed in years ago, those yellow monks' robes. And so these bees all might be monks. I don't know. You're joining me from all over the country. The other day, it was Dubai. It was Canada. It was Australia, Germany. A couple of folks from Germany. Fun time. I like croquet balls are all colors. There's a red one here with a couple of white stripes on it. There they are right there. Later in the holidays, I left. Here's this one right here. This is the Terry Tardy turquoise one. All right, that's a little thick, so watch what I'm going to do. I'm going to go back in and just touch it one time, and look what happened. See? Just left it with a little bit of that showing right there. Here's an orange-colored one right here. The reason I didn't go green is because the grass is probably going to be green. There's a mallet, and they're kind of rusty wood color because mine were all mallet. I made two croquet mallets, and I used to play with a croquet mallet that I actually made. And it was weighted and heavy, and I was actually, this is, and the stories I tell you, listen, and thank you, Pat. Pat says they are fabulous classes. Thank you for people who are asking. I can't see that. You know, I didn't even know I was ever going to teach a class. And so what I do is not much different than here. I go into a little slower detail. I give you some assignments to paint on the days and the time you have off. And then we catch up. What I am going to do in 8:57, for those of you who are getting ready to start the class this next week, and it'll open to you, is that I am going to I'm going to ask that you find some sort of journal, because we're going to talk about journaling and how you can do quick, fast pieces of art and capture some pieces. Not just carrying your phone or your camera all the time. I said phone, didn't I? Yeah, I did. Isn't it amazing? You know, it's really crazy how much you shoot pictures nowadays with the phone, and you don't even go get your beautiful cameras anymore. So powerful lenses are so great. Okay, so there you go. There's a little bit of this. I need just a little bit of blue sky, and I'm going to come in right onto the wire here. Ooh, Doc Watson is singing. So hush, little baby, don't you cry. I'll never forget when I was a freshman in high school. I was growing then and getting strong, and they didn't know what they were going to do with me. And I was told one day by a couple of the varsity players that you're going to be the B team. And that just fired me up to tell them, you're not going to believe where I'm going to show up. I'm going to take your job. And so that's my competitive piece that I hit back then when I was into athletics. And so I became a decathlete, because I could throw and run and jump. I couldn't pole vault, but fascinating. So here comes the B team. There it is right there. And this one right here is, let's do that old song. Let's go down to the rock pile and get a little bolder. All right, I'm laughing at my joke there. It's an old song. It really wasn't a song. It was just an old line we used to do. Let's go down to the rock pile, honey, and get a little bolder. There you go. There's your two two paintings from this morning. How fun was that, huh? All right. Hey, you guys are blessed. I'll see you Monday probably on this show. Right now, take a last sip of this. You've become such a great community that I know that you are, because I see you talking to one another, and it's just fascinating. You know, you don't care if I'm here or not. I'm just the excuse to get you all to go together, and I love that. There's something about that that's so humbling that I love. Take your last sip today. Think of two people right now. I got two on my wall right now. They're written down right there. I could show you their names, but I'm not going to. And they will get a text as soon as this show's over. So two people today that you need to send a greeting to, a note to, a well wish to, a thought to, a prayer to, a hope to, something that you could do on this Saturday. It's a little gray here today. I'll go say hi to Dan in a minute. And have another cup of tea and maybe a piece of fresh coffee cake. I owe you a scone recipe, and that's coming to you. Maybe next week, maybe Monday or Tuesday, I'll get you the scone recipe. And then I've got to go work today starting at 3:00. All of the mugs have made it, and all the labels are getting printed finally. Thank you, all right, for your patience on that. Looking forward to turning a mug around Monday morning. And it's going to have the Roodoodles mug on it. So blessings to you. Send somebody a text right now. I'm having my last sip of cuppa. Cuppa sippa. Sippa sippa cuppa. I am out of here like a herd of turtles. This sounds like an accordion, right?